part of what is very, very important in life is the health of our body. So I like to start every time people get together with a healing treatment of consciousness that deals with the health of our body. So I'm going to ask if you would just sit back in your chairs, let your eyes close, and think along with me for a few moments. I turn inward to the very highest state of consciousness and reality that exists here within me, a higher reality that has been the source of producing life within my body and maintaining the life of my body. For here within myself is the beauty, the presence, the mind, and the spirit of universal life. And so I recline back into my own mind, back into the consciousness of higher awareness. And as I do, I release the entirety of the workings of my body to the consciousness of eternal life that dwells within it. For my body is as a field of energy, and the consciousness that is within it is part of the eternal mind, primal energy of the universe, conscious and of God. Here within myself, the body is as a chemical laboratory, governed over by the great physician that created it and maintains it. The primal light energy of God's presence here at the very center and nucleus of my mind. And so here within that divine center, I open myself wide, very, very wide, to that power that both created me and maintains the health of my body. Right here and right now, that light flows into every one of the millions of cells of my body, into the very center of each cell. They're directing the energy flow of life activity, bringing into balance all the rhythms, motions, and energies of the life activity of every cell of my body, outwardly and inwardly. That every internal organ within my body vibrates in perfect harmony with the universal life process that is God. And so I let go, releasing myself into this higher realm of presence, this higher realm of majesty, beauty, and divine order, that the orderly processes of my body now are in alignment with the flow of the universe as the planets make their way through their orbits around the sun. Governed by divine order, so everything within my body flows with the divine order of universal life. And that if there be any ill energy within my body, that energy is being sublimated by the healing light process, reestablishing an orderliness within every cell of my body, within all of the internal functionings of every organ of my body. I let go to that great mind, that great consciousness, that is the ultimate and true life of my body, the eternal, the universal, the perfect state of beingness that is God. for the health renewing and health maintaining consciousness that is, I give thanks. I let it be so, and so it is. Last week, I gave some thoughts about the idea pertaining to what is being popularized as the so-called secret. Notice I preface the word secret by the word so-called. Every once in a while, there is what we call the spiritual flavor of the month. And that is basically what is taking place right now. I sent a memo to many of our university students with the University of Metaphysics in Sedona, basically saying that whatever is being presented right now is primarily sandbox and kindergarten understanding of the workings of the human mind. It is a rehash of basically positive thinking. It's been around for a long, long, long time. It's been presented under various forms by motivational speakers, and it has been presented in what we call the New Thought Movement. Now, if you're not familiar with the New Thought Movement basically comprises the Unity Church and also the Church of Religious Science, along with the Divine Science Church and numerous other churches that go along the lines of what we call New Thought. Incorporating into this, actually, is the Christian Science Church, which began to teach along these lines before the others that I've just mentioned. What all of this means is this, that what is being presented right now is another rerun, as it were, of what has been around for a long, long time. If you happened to watch our broadcast last Sunday, I mentioned that all of this, really, except for a few people, does not work. And I tried to point out why it doesn't work. Now, of course, the populace of our society say, well, if it was presented on Larry King and on Oprah, it must be so. Dear hearts, please understand one thing. I have nothing but the highest respect for Larry King. I love his broadcasts. I watch them practically every night when I'm having dinner. And the same thing with Oprah. I have nothing but the highest respect for her and a lot of the wonderful work that she has done. Having said and paid my respects, beyond that, the idea that is being fostered is 1% reality and 99% falsehood. Now, how do I know this? What gives me the authority to pass this type of opinion? I have worked full-time, as I stated last week, for nearly 50 years, nearly a half a century, working in the trenches of consciousness with tens of thousands of students, dealing with the deepest levels of the mind. For those that are more esoterically inclined, from the alchemical to the mystical, to just about everything that you can think of and imagine. I have taught the mysteries and magic of mysticism from all of the major religions, from Hinduism to Buddhism to mystical Christianity to Zen. I'm hardly new. I know I don't look new. And maybe that'll substantiate that maybe I have been around. But I have been on this planet doing this. This has been my whole life's dedication. Now, I have been involved in many different new areas to try to get spiritual truth across to people. And part of that is to deal with some of the areas that are being presented as this so-called magnificent secret. Let me put it to you this way. That so-called secret has been taught in these New Thought churches all of this time, and I have nothing but the highest respect for the New Thought churches because they've tried to take and progress religion beyond traditional religion. However, that too doesn't mean that they're right. I'm backing myself into a corner here where I'm going to say that really traditional Christianity exists for one particular reason, and then there is another type of Christianity, which we'll get into in a moment. So what I am saying, in effect, is this, that there are two basic premises, maybe three, in this so-called secret that is being popularized nowadays. One is positive thinking, which has been around since Norman Vincent Peale and before that, and there is no doubt that being positive is much better than being negative. Being positive is much better as far as your occupation, your career, your personal relationships, your health. All of this has been proven, the effect of being positive as opposed to the effect of being pessimistic. Also, there is nothing new here in terms of energy. We have talked in mysticism about energy exchange and so forth. I was teaching about energy 50 years ago. Anybody who goes into higher states of consciousness recognizes that the human mind and consciousness is one vast field of energy. Now, the next thing is about beyond positive thinking. The next thing that's being presented is the idea of imaging, i.e., visualizing something. All right, visualizing simply means that you keep something at the forefront of your mind on a psychological level if you don't have a spiritual connection. And notice what I said, a spiritual connection. The spiritual connection does not come from a philosophical, metaphysical acceptance of the concept that the universe is one life and that we are all manifestations of that one life. That is the philosophical, cerebral acceptance, but that doesn't necessarily make you connected. Now, that is being really basically what is espoused in so-called New Thought churches, which today are saying, hey, we teach it and we live it. And I say, so what? There's an old expression that I grew up with which says the proof is in the pudding. Put up or shut up. When I went into this field, I wanted to know what could improve human life, the human mind, and human nature. I drew upon psychology, philosophy, religion, all of the isms, all of the ologies. I explored them. And then I did something that the others didn't do. I kept track of the results. And when you keep track of the results, I can tell you this. When I say the proof is in the pudding, right now people are being told they can have it anything. They can have it all. And they can tell the universe just what they want. And they're going to get it. If this were the case, all of these people sitting in all of these churches, some of them for decades, would have won it all. Most of them, at best, are just being massaged with the hopelessness of hope, false hope. And why? Here we get to the big cloudy issue. The big cloudy issue right now, there's nothing wrong with the positive thinking. There's nothing wrong with the imaging, which says they're focusing. There's nothing wrong with the law of attraction, that like attracts like, because on an unconscious level, there is an interplay between all living things, beings, animate and inanimate. But when you put before the public that the mind is like a slate and that there is like a magic genie which can appear and say, ask and I'll give it to you, whatever you want, I'll give it to you, that is total falsehood, total foolishness, And that is why these people sit in these churches, follow this type of philosophy year after year after year, and apart from a little bit of feeling good, feeling a little bit more optimistic, feeling that if they can just keep up this mirage long enough, something will really happen, and it doesn't. It only happens for a few. Those few who would have gotten it anyway. Those few who would have materialized anyway. Now, in this supposed secret, they point out great minds through history, great personalities through history. Plato, Beethoven, Emerson. They almost allude that all of these great minds use this to get ahead in their life, to be what they became. As if all of them were imaging every day, and that's why Beethoven created these great symphonies, why Plato became this great philosopher. No. It is the total opposite and antithesis of that type of methodology. The popularized baloney secret says this: you think it into the mind of the universe and it will happen. In other words, put a thought into the mind of the universe and it will happen. The reality is that the universe, for it to happen for you, should put a thought in your mind. Instead of you putting a thought into the mind of God, God puts a thought into your mind exactly as to what you should do, what you should be doing it, the greatness of your soul, what your soul's mission is in this particular lifetime. And that is why what is being taught, that is, if one droplet of the ocean, though it is part of the ocean, can direct the ebb and flow of the tides of the ocean, is totally false. The ocean is totally aware of the totality of the ocean and knows what is good for every drop of water that it contains. We operate here with a very little bit of our surface mind. That is an input of people's opinions based upon our parents, be they ever so well-meaning, our teachers, be they ever so well-meaning, religions, be they ever so well-meaning. And so we are, on a surface level, a composite of different opinions. We form what we need or we think we want based upon the input coming from the outside in, rather than your soul with its reality and what God created you for emerging from within you. Now, St. Paul once said, "Let the mind be in you that was in Christ." It's in the New Testament. It alludes to the idea that you are capable of having a Christ-like mind. The Christ-like mind is in a state of connection with the higher consciousness. And what I pointed out in our broadcast last week very simply was that you cannot get anywhere in life while you become a house, while you remain a house divided against itself, which simply means this. Jesus put it this way: you can't put new wine into old bottles. You can't take and put all this positive thinking and so forth in the conscious level of your mind while the stench of negative karma, trauma, continues inside of you. Which means that the thing that most people don't want to take the time to do, and that is, if you're going to connect with God, you have to have an internal cleansing of your consciousness, or otherwise whatever positiveness you're thinking on a conscious level will be neutralized by your unconscious. Psychologists will tell you that
the conscious level of the mind is 90% not under its own influence, but by the karma or by the consciousness that has already been accumulated in it. Therefore, you are subject to whatever is taking place inside of your mind. What has been there is part of the history of your mind. And until you clear up your own history, until you clear up what I termed last week, the garbage can of your mind, you will be in constant conflict, and no matter what you think, no matter what system you use, you will be in conflict with the surface level of your thinking, which will neutralize all your aspirations and will take all of this dribble that you're being given and told in this so-called secret and just neutralize it to where you just get nowhere. You sit in congregations, you sit in motivational seminars, and you get nowhere until the job is done. I had one student one time that started studying in this field, and she recognized that she had a lot of this stuff inside of her, and that as she started to study to become more positive and so forth, she was being neutralized by this stuff. So not knowing exactly what to do, she went to a couple of therapists and spent a lot of time there trying to clean this act up. Actually, she progressed pretty well because she wasn't then the house divided against itself. So having said that, realize that it is not what we tell God to do that makes people great and makes their mark in history, a la what is being presented. Plato, Emerson, all of these people did not sit around practicing kindergarten mental physics. They were inspired by the universe. They were channels of the universe. And until any person becomes a vehicle and a channel for universal consciousness, you will fall far short of finding the right person, living a life of happiness, living a life of fulfillment, and the so-called things and the goodies of life. And that is why Christ advised Jesus with a Christ mind, channeling through the consciousness of the universe, seek first the kingdom of heaven, and then all things will be added to you. Not seek first a commercialism of mental techniques, it won't work. So all of these people that are sitting around talking about this so-called secret are not talking about anything that's been a secret, but that which has been proven to be ineffective except for the things that I first said. It'll make you feel better. It'll be better that you think positively than negatively. It will be better if you do image and visualize because it'll maintain your focus if you're driving towards a particular goal so that even an atheist can materialize, even a greedy person can materialize because the mental principle is the same. But in the process, the greedy person, the person that wants only money, 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 ends up with money but has paid a price. And it was in the words, as Jesus tried to explain, what profiteth a man if he gaineth the world, but loseth his soul? Whatever we gain, let's not pay the big price for it. You have people today that by worldly standards are well off, but by standards within themselves, are miserable. The idea is to achieve a balance, achieve a reality. Let's take a look at these affirmations that are in your programs here this morning. It's titled Total Wealth, Material, Mental, and Spiritual. Because unless you have all of those material, mental, and spiritual, you don't really have total wealth. And yet, at the same time, you have to realize that there is a fine, fine balance between what we talk about as wealth. So let's get right into it. The first says two Christianities. It says, I understand that there are two Christianities, and I tried to explain that a few times here recently. The outer for the mass of souls who are yet unable to comprehend the subtleties and the complexities of the simplest truth of all. And the other secret Christianity of the disciples, made known only to a few, when ready to enter into the mysteries of knowingness or Christ-mind consciousness, have it inwardly revealed to them. In the New Testament, it says that you've had these things revealed to you as Jesus spoke to the disciples. Many people have sought to see these things that you've seen and haven't seen them. At the same time, he spoke in parables. He spoke in parables. One was for the outer Christianity, as we call it, the Christianity that all of you are familiar with, what I call churchdom, and the inner for the disciples. The outer was for people that could not really understand the subtleties and the complexities of what he was teaching his immediate group of disciples. I'm sure you will agree that in any setting, there are those souls that are able to comprehend things and those souls that are not. And when we're dealing with the subtleties and mysteries of universal life itself, then it becomes very, very complex indeed. So what we're dealing with here, and what I'm going to go into here in the next few moments, is the subtleties, the complexities, and try to make them as simple as possible. First it says total wealth. It says, I recognize that my prospering materially, mentally, and spiritually is as a result of my living in Christ-mind consciousness as guided intuitively by universal consciousness or God. Now, each of us has our own definition of what wealth is. To me, wealth is a balance between all of these things, the prospering, the material, the physical, the mental. It is a fine balance. Wealth, to me, does not necessarily represent living in a mansion and driving a Rolls Royce. I was rather amused last night when I went through my mail. For many, many years, people that have taken classes with me say, oh, I want to demonstrate a Mercedes-Benz. And I've kept saying to them, why do you limit yourself? And they'd look at me with questioning looks in their eyes. Well, a Mercedes-Benz. Well, I got the Consumer Report in my mail last night. And I chuckled to myself as I went through the evaluations of all the different manufacturers that the Mercedes-Benz was down there at the bottom of the heap. Yes, indeed. They gave every manufacturer, Chrysler, Ford, Toyota, Honda, the whole of it, and they said, of all of the different models of every company, what percentage would you recommend? The only one that had 0% recommendation was Mercedes-Benz. Isn't that interesting? Yeah. For those of you who are curious, the Honda had 100% recommendation on all their models. All right, moving on. So, maybe this something is not necessarily a dream car. Christ. I recognize that the word Christ refers to the state of consciousness or mind level within me, where my existence is as an eternal state of oneness with universal consciousness or God. Let me repeat that. What is Christ? We say Jesus Christ. Jesus the Christ. Once again, I recognize the word Christ refers to that state of consciousness or mind level within me or within Jesus, where my existence or Jesus' existence is in a state of eternal oneness with universal consciousness or God. That is what we refer to as the anointed mind, the Christ-like mind, the mind that was anointed with higher consciousness, a state of oneness with the universe, where you recognize that inside of your body there is a state of eternal oneness with universal life. That is really what is meant by the Christ. Jesus took no credit for anything that he did. If you go to the New Testament, while traditional outer Christianity gives total credit, It's in the New Testament. Why call me good? It is not I that doeth these good works, but the Father. The oneness of God within us. That Christ-like state of mind within us. Priority. I recognize that my first priority in life is to live in Christ mind consciousness. Not to live in consumerism consciousness. Not to live in what type of house consciousness I'm going to live in. Not to live in what kind of car consciousness I'm going to drive. Not to live in what and who my arm candy is going to be. But the first priority is to seek the highest state of reality, consciousness, and mind that all of you are capable of. That should be where our consciousness is centered. Inwardly, to live in Christ mind consciousness, that I may be inwardly connected to universal consciousness or God, to be in charge of my thinking and feeling nature, that I may receive total wealth according to God's wisdom and will for the enrichment of my soul in this life and beyond. What is total wealth? I live in total wealth, but I don't live in a mansion. I live in total wealth, but I don't drive a Rolls Royce. And right now, I don't look for a Mercedes either. I live in a very comfortably. That comfortableness is just fine for me. I don't need a big house. I don't need the goody-goodies. Yet I am really actually prosperous. I have a wealth that is based on total wealth, which is the wealth of my mind, my body, my soul, my spirit, and all of the outer trappings that most people would think I'm pretty fortunate to have. And yet, I really haven't done anything. I really haven't. Jesus said, I of myself do nothing. It is the Father that doeth these good works. In the process of the last 50 years, I've taught countless numbers of people the truth according to how they are able to comprehend it. Over the past 3 decades, I've taught and graduated over 15,000 students to teach in this field. Why isn't this out in the public's open? Because they teach under various labels. It isn't under one banner. But right now, there are thousands of people out there that I personally taught to be teachers that are teaching. I established 2 different schools of higher education to do this. I have an international then ministry of people that report to me every month under various names. Now, did I use the power of positive thinking? Well, I was optimistic, or else I wouldn't have done anything. Did I focus? I only focused on light and God's presence within me. Did I have anything to do with it? Absolutely nothing. Whatever I've accomplished, and if you really knew what's been accomplished, it hasn't been through I. I've just been a vehicle. Whatever person has accomplished through the pages of history was not accomplished through their mental surface level mind effort. The surface mind is but a tool, like the pair of pliers that you would have in a toolkit, or a hammer, or a screwdriver. The surface level of the mind is an outer perimeter of a circular motion of energy that emanates forth from the human heart, where the true connection with the infinite and the eternal exists within each and every one of us. And so all I've done is just to work in spiritual automatic, as I call it. Cleanse, contact, and work intuitively. Cleanse contact and work intuitively. I've not had a physical family, but my students over the years have really been my family, those that have studied with me. And it's a very full family. I have probably one of the biggest families you'll ever know. And possibly more grateful than some of your relatives might be. I saw a slogan one time that God created friends to make up for your relatives. All right. It says that I may receive total wealth according to God's wisdom and will for the enrichment of my soul in this lifetime and beyond. That's what we're here for. The enrichment of our souls for this lifetime and beyond. It says, source, I recognize that my real source for a life of total wealth comes from the universal consciousness of God within me, channeled through the Christ mind intuitive awareness active in me. That's where we're at. We don't cause anything to happen. We open ourselves up and allow the universe to work through us and make it happen for us. In other words, whatever good happens to me, I'm an innocent bystander. Whatever good happens to you, you are an innocent bystander. We open ourselves up for the possibility of this by not trying to tell the universe what to do, but by allowing the universe to tell us what to do. You can understand, therefore, that what is being presented in mass media is the total opposite from any type of real spiritual reality and truth. It is total garbage. And it is very, very interesting that on the internet in recent days, people that really know what the spiritual reality is are pouring out and letting these producers who made a nice film, well done film, but never bothered to crawl out of the sandbox themselves and surrounded themselves with people who are still in the sandbox along with them. And again, these are some of the so-called big names of the motivational, metaphysical, New Age movement who have never really touched on real connection within themselves apart from a philosophical acceptance that this must be true and backed up now by some science which has always been there. And so you have literally once again the blind leading the blind in new packages, new bows, new ribbons, and nobody will get anywhere until God tells the conscious mind what to do. Until intuitional processes are opened up inside of you and you become a vehicle and a channel, not for some person that has passed on and pretends to be some type of divine being, but rather the consciousness of Almighty God, the universe living within you. Now you can tell from the sound of my voice, I feel pretty strongly about this. And it is not based on some type of emotional hype that people get caught up in and frenzied in. You know, there used to be this speaker, and I've talked about him many times. My father saw him in the 1930s. He used to come on stage. He was a motivational speaker, mixed in a little bit of the metaphysical along with it, and he would walk up and down. He wouldn't say a word when he came onto the stage. He'd walk up and down, and he'd pace, and people would wonder, why in the blazes doesn't he say something? Suddenly, he'd turn on the audience, and he'd say, all of you want to go to heaven. None of you want to die. He who loseth himself for my sake shall find himself. He who loses their personal ego on the aspiration of the foolishness of men shall find the reality of God and what their purpose in life will be, and then they will be totally wealthy, for they will have found their treasure where their heart is, where thieves do not break in the night and steal their cars, their wealth, their fame, their notoriety, where that which is transitory long since passes over, but that which is permanent within each and every one of us remains as our permanent state of total wealth. So, the next word is a key word. It says knowing. So much emphasis is placed upon thought in these so-called secret things. Jesus said, "Which of you, by taking thought, can add one cubit to their stature?" He anticipated all of these things, which means this. He said, "Be as the lilies of the field, they spin and they toil not." They don't image, they don't focus, and yet Solomon in all of his glory was not adorned as one of these. If you were to go into a state of higher consciousness, which I have made my whole life doing, and to communicate, let's suppose that right now I'm in a state of higher consciousness and I come into contact with a very, very higher state of beingness, a higher being. There is no thought exchanged. There is communication, but no thought. I repeat, there is communication, but no thought. Not thought as we understand it. There is knowingness. Above all things, even wisdom is love. There is the communication of love. There is the communication of knowingness. Not a thought process. In higher realms, there is not the thought process that we think of here. There is simply knowingness. And so, if we start to say the power of thought does have a little bit of power, but it pales in significance to knowing. It is the idea of love. You meet somebody and you can get one of those little daisies and say, "He loves me, he loves me not, he loves me, he loves me not, he loves me, he loves me not," and hope that the final petal will be in your favor. But when you do this, it is different than if you meet someone and it is knowing. It is not based on need. It is not based on obsession. It is not based on symbolism. You just simply know. It's love. There's no need, then, for a discussion. It says, "Knowing, I recognize that total wealth is achieved not through mortal thinking something into existence." Let me repeat that. Not through mortal thinking something into existence, but by Christ mind knowing, intuitively guided by universal consciousness or God, as to both thinking and feeling. In other words, the universe inside of each and every one of you causes you to think a certain way, causes you to feel a certain way. Now, so much is made about the thinking and feeling process in this so-called baloney secret that's out there. And what I'm saying to you is that until it emanates from within you, until the source inside of you, until the God inside of you creates your thinking, creates your feeling, then all the input from all the advertisers, all mass media, all telling you what you think you should have, what you think you should be, what you think you should want, is so much hype, will never lead to anything, and will leave you then more forlorn than when you went into this whole thing, because when you get through with it and nothing has happened, you're going to be discouraged and you'll say, "The whole thing, all of this is bunk. I'm just going to live for today, to hell with everything." Or you might just sit there for another 30 or 50 years and let these people just continue to massage you with all this false hope that if you just keep doing these things, friends, you because they'll point to maybe five people out of every hundred that have materialized anything more than a parking space. And they will say, see, look at, come up here and tell us about your demonstration. Those people would have had it anyway. Many are called, few are chosen. That's just the way life is. If you're going to build a building, there can only be those that are the architects and those that are the workers. The one thing, however, in an enlightened society is that the worker, the ditch digger, is as important as the architect. That's the difference in an enlightened society. In an enlightened society, we're all the same because we all know we're one life. Each of us has our way. One is going to be the architect, the other is going to be there with a shovel. Both are the same in the eyes of the universe because both are the universe, each doing the universe's business, or I am about my Father's business. Turn the card. Surprise. There's more. Wealth goals. I recognize that total wealth is achieved when my outer thinking and feeling processes are intuitively guided by knowing what my goals are, established not by mortal mind level limitations. Your mortal mind has limitations. But by the all-knowing universal God consciousness within me, channeled through Christ-mindedness. Worldly wealth. I recognize that worldly wealth can be achieved in making money and material possessions the number one priority or focus on the outer mortal mind, but that in so doing, connection with universal consciousness or total wealth is almost impossible and can lead to unhappiness, emptiness within, and escapisms with and in spite of worldly wealth. And that's the way it is. That is why the old idea, it's not impossible, but it is harder for the camel to pass through the eye of a needle than a rich person to enter into the kingdom of heaven. Why? Because the focus is just on money. If that's your focus, if that's what you want, kids, go after it. Go after it and see what you end up with. Again, you're not a whole person. You're not living a whole life. And without that, the pot at the end of the rainbow is empty. Lasting wealth. I recognize that anything lasting must be eternal. Does that make sense to you? If it's anything that's lasting, it's got to be eternal. Let's go with extremes to make the point. If anything's going to last, it's got to be eternal. So I seek as my first priority to be one with the eternal part of me as the lasting treasure which provides for me in this life and beyond it through eternity. That's the way it is. Everything you get into this idea, you get into this frame of mind, which is a state of energy that deals with the eternal. Cleansing. I mentioned that a few moments ago. I recognize that the mortal levels of consciousness within me must be cleansed of negative karma, trauma, thinking, and feeling, or I will be in conflict with Christ-mindedness and thus block the intuitive channels of universal consciousness to achieve total wealth. So, if you've got a mess, work on cleaning it up. Not just on a surface level, because if all you do is to try to be optimistic on a surface level and say, I am one with this car, I am one with this home, so what? Another part of you is saying, no, you stinker, you're kidding yourself, you're self-deluded, you don't deserve it, you're guilty of this, you're guilty of that, you're a sinner, you're no good, blah, 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 yak, 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 yada, 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 yada. Sometimes you got to quote Seinfeld. I mean, you know. All right. will. I daily give up my personal will and corresponding mortal thinking and feeling to the will of universal God consciousness, which provides me with the knowing to live in total wealth. Jesus put it to his disciples this way. Unless a man doeth the will of my Father, he in no way will enter the kingdom of heaven. The kingdom of heaven is a higher state of consciousness where we make the connection with the source, with God, which does provide. So then we get to reality. And here's the hard pill for people to swallow. I recognize that while there is a physical abundance of all things for all people, that only a few achieve total wealth. For the universal God consciousness only provides to its creations the power inherent in knowingness that they are prepared to experience, to not destroy themselves and others through a mortally obstructed view of reality. When you go home, or those of you that are home that get these affirmations, read over that last affirmation until such time as you truly understand it. In other words, we can give power to those that are unprepared to handle power. If such things, such naivete as the secret popularized worked, there would be chaos in this universe right now. Because people are not prepared to have and to control certain things. It is like the way of the world today, where we stand on the brink of annihilation, where we have leaders in all countries unprepared to handle the technological power that has been given to them. And so if we do mental power, and just our thoughts are things, which they are, then it would run out of control. Many years ago, when I was young, there was a picture that came out, and I encourage all of you to see it. It's still available. It's a classic in the motion picture field. It was a science fiction picture. It was called The Forbidden Planet. Any of you ever see it here? Anybody here? The Forbidden Planet was a thing about where people landed on a planet, and they found a very, very advanced civilization had lived there. All of these advancements that were far, far ahead of these space travelers. And they wondered, where did all of this, what happened to this civilization? It doesn't seem like there were any wars here or anything. I mean, all the buildings are intact, all of the machines, the equipment, nothing seems to be destroyed here. What happened to this great civilization? Germ warfare? What? Well, finally, this great mystery at the end of the picture is solved. They come across where there are records of what actually took place. And what actually took place was that the power of the use of the mind, only the mind, had grown to such a point where indeed the mind had the power to materialize into physical form. The final step had been given to this civilization. And then they all went to sleep that night. The leader gave them this final step to be able to materialize whatever you want. That your mind now has the key to materializing whatever you want. During that night, whatever was in the deepest levels of their mind, negativity that had never been destroyed, trauma, hate, anger, all of these became like tremendous monsters which materialized themselves on the face of the planet and destroyed all life forms on the planet. In other words, the thought forms of their unconscious engulfed them. And that is why the universe will only measure out to all of its creations that which on a surface level the creation is able to handle. Nothing more, nothing less. In every generation, in every decade, in every millennium, you will find souls that seem to be out in front. Contributors, whether philosophers, artists, whatever they might be, always seem to be the ones that will go down in history. A little bit, those particular souls were born with the idea in mind that they will release a little bit more of the consciousness of the universe to their respective people, their respective generation. And so you will always find those few. This particular lecture is dedicated to those few. If you watching are among those few, you already know who you are, because you're already under the influence of not my thinking, nor anyone else's thinking, but of a higher mind that is inside of you, that is directing your thoughts, your aspirations, your goals, your creativity, and your very soul lives in a perpetual state of fulfillment in this state of non-thinking knowingness. Let us take a few moments to try to retrace ourselves back into this state of higher consciousness within ourselves. Those of you that are here, sit upright in your chairs. Those of you that are at home, do the same. Let your eyes close, because with the eyes closed, we can begin to really see. And what do we see? We see that which is hidden within us, that which is at the very center and nucleus of our minds. I turn away from the outer world for a few moments, that I may enter into the inner world of my own mind, soul, and spirit, to walk through that mental pathway that mystics down through the ages have entered into, to become under the influence of that which the great minds through history have been influenced by, to travel now through the corridors and pathways of consciousness within me, that I may see and come into contact with the reality of the profoundness of who and what I am, in a state of oneness with the mind of the universe, the spirit of eternal life. And thus I may stand and take my place in consciousness amongst the stars and the planets, that I may be here in physical form, and yet a part of my light body exists endlessly in multi-dimensions simultaneously, where I am both human and godlike, where I am in a state of perpetual eternal oneness with the perfect mind that was in Christ, that was in Buddha, that was in Krishna, that was in all of the wise down through the ages, an awareness, a kinship with the life process of eternity. And so I move and turn consciousness inward upon itself, that my mind may yield the mysteries of the heavenly presence within my nature, that which transcends my mortal state of thinking, that which takes me and causes me to arrive into a state of knowingness, where time and space stand still, and all is
as one unending field of light. For the reality is who and what I am, and I am that which I am. And so let me feel that the mind that was in Christ is the same mind that I turn over my body to, my life to, that mind that knows I'm in this world, but one with the eternal light that I am beyond this world, that I channel the light of goodness, of love, of wisdom, and of the treasure of the divine heart of the Almighty in and through me. For a few moments, I sit in the silence of my own contemplation to sense this, to feel it, to be one with it. I sense and I feel a greater sense of selfhood, wholeness, and completeness. Through my arms, my legs, my body, my hands, my feet, throughout the upper torso of my body, as if there is a higher existence that exists here, and that I may come to know the meaning of the words, peace, be still, and know that I am God, here, within you. In a few moments, I'll begin to open my eyes ever so slowly, and my senses to the outer world that surrounds me once again. But though I do this, I will retain my inner sense of feeling and connection with a higher reality that is within me, that reality may put thought into my mind, and that I may enter into a conscious cooperation with the will of the universe working through me to accomplish total wealth. And so very slowly now I'll begin to open my eyes, and as I open my eyes I'll stretch my arms and my hands high over my head, and I do this in a symbolic gesture only of always reaching for something higher in my life, but knowing that that something higher that I reach for is to be found in the height of who and what I truly am within myself, a living, breathing manifestation of the stars of the heavens, of universal life, mind, having taken image, shape, form, and embodiment. I bring down my hands, resting in this my true security, letting it be so throughout me, and so it is.